Just a few announcements for this morning. Next Sunday will be our annual Super Bowl of Caring. Actually, it's two Sundays. When the youth of our church will be in the narthex with soup bowls and soup pots to collect money for homeless people. This is springs from the Presbyterian Church in Columbia, South Carolina, with concern about hungry people in their community down there, and they started this movement on Super Bowl Sunday. Let's make up a collection, get some of these folks a bowl of soup to eat, and it's grown nationwide ever since. So our youth will be in the narthex next Sunday, I believe. Sunday after that, before and after worship, next Sunday.
Also tell the youth, forgive me for jumping in, wear your favorite jersey, football jersey. Tyler, I think you can wear the Ravens jersey if you really have to. But we want you to wear their favorite football jerseys out there too.
Forgive me. Tom has asked all of the youth to wear their favorite football jersey. It doesn't have to be the team tag, or whatever your team is. Whatever your favorite football jersey is, wear it. It'll be awesome. Valentine Luncheon is on Sunday, February the 13th, immediately following worship. And the shepherds are asking that those in their flock, we all sit together, the shepherds with their flock, sit together so we can get to know each other in our flock, and the shepherds can get to know us, and we get to know the shepherds, and all of that. So keep that in mind for 2 weeks from today. And then passing February newsette will be published this week. Any passing news or articles or anything you want Anne to put in there need to be to her today, right in front of the office. We gather together to ask for God's blessing, to turn to a wisdom surpassing our own. The powers that oppress us now cease to distress us. O God, be present with us and make your will known. Please stand and sing a processional hymn, number 276. We gather together to ask for the Lord's blessing.
Thank you.
Almighty Creator of the universe, we come before you today attempting to find humility, attempting to simply be in worship of you. Let your Spirit move through us and remind us that it is not our own understanding or wisdom that brings about your kingdom, but your will and your wisdom. Help us to lean on the words of your Son as we pray, saying,
Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever.
Ready to go on a trip, and her mom didn't realize her dad was best friend here in Richmond, Neil Fuzzy Lambert, who is going through triple bypass surgery tomorrow. And finally, Hazel Hyder's daughter, Nelda, had a run-in with the car on last Sunday, I believe. She was out running and managed to keep herself from being run over and didn't have any broken bones, but she was hit by a car and is going through a good deal of therapy to get muscles and nerves back correct. And Lewis.
Linda Spencer come down last night and couldn't get out of bed this morning.
Linda Spencer also came down with a stomach illness, I believe, last night and couldn't make it out of bed this morning either, so let's add Linda Spencer to our prayers as well. It's an awful lot going on right now, and these are only the ones that we know of, so let's go to God in prayer. The Lord be with you. Let us pray. Great healer, we come before you today with this long list of pain, of sickness, and of sorrow. And we ask today that you be with Mark and Carol and the doctors as they try to figure out what's going on. That you be with Linda and Elvin as they try to make some hard decisions. We ask that you be with Hazel and with her daughter Nelda as she goes through this recovery. We pray for the family of Debbie Galef as they go through this time of pain and mourning as they try to sort out everything that's happening to them. We pray your healing touch for Fuzzy Lambert, that you be with his doctors as he goes through the surgery tomorrow. God, we ask that you be with all of those here whose needs and cares and hurts are not named. We pray for them. We pray that your presence be with all of us. You know what a mess we can find our lives in, what a mess our world is in. So God, we ask that you be with us. Help us in the midst of these trying times. Help us to be your people. Help us to know that you are with us, even in the midst of the strife, in the midst of the sorrow. Help us to be your hands and feet, to be present for those who so desperately need you. Whether it is needing just to know your existence or to know your specific presence for specific pain. God, we ask that you be with all of these people. We ask that you help us to be your hands and feet. We ask all of this in Jesus' name.
Thank you. This is my friend Pocky. He and I have been friends since I was old, about 10 or 11. When I was little, I used to be afraid of the dark, and I would sleep with something much like Pocky to give me a little sense of security. What are you guys afraid of? Anybody else afraid of the dark? What about you guys on our chair? What are you guys afraid of? Okay, what do you guys do when you're afraid? Hide. I mean, you guys pray when you're scared. Do you pray when you're scared? You pray when you're scared. Do you tell mommy and daddy what you're afraid of? Yes, you tell mommy and daddy what you're afraid of. Well, when I was really little, another thing I was afraid of was getting lost in the supermarket with my mom. I was afraid that I would lose her and never find her, and nobody would know where I was. But I seem to forget that God is always with me. And the Bible says to be strong and courageous, and do not be afraid or terrified, because God goes with you, and He will never leave you or forsake you. So I want you guys to remember that when you're scared, God is always with you. He's standing with you. He's holding your hand. He's walking with you everywhere you go. So there's no need to be afraid. All right, let's pray. Dear Lord, we are so thankful that you are always with us, even in our fears. And we thank you that you cover us and help us to not be as afraid. We ask that you continue to go with us everywhere we go and to ease our fears. Yes, we pray in the name of Jesus. Amen.
Love.
So it was on that night that Jesus gathered together with his disciples to tell them about the sacrifice he was about to make for them and for all the world. And he took a loaf of bread and he blessed it and he broke it, saying, "This is my body, broken for you." And in the same way, after supper, he took the cup. He blessed it and he poured it, saying, "This is my blood, the blood of the new covenant, poured out for the forgiveness of the sins of many. Do this in remembrance of me."
This beautiful day, the
bread of life. As often as we eat of the bread and drink of the cup, we proclaim Christ's death and resurrection until he comes again.
My wife and I exchanged Christmas gifts in an unusual way this year. Central African Tonga tune that is in our hymn book. But the choir was snowed out long last year. So you don't get to hear the djembe yet, but you will. So I did not arrange this piece this morning. I pulled out a piece that I had written a couple of years ago in this text and sort of gave it an instrument that we had available. You can follow this text in the scripture that was read earlier in Matthew 5. Old Testament lesson this morning comes from the prophet Micah. It can be found printed in your pew Bibles on page 1447. It's Micah chapter 6, verses 1 through 8. Listen to what the Lord says. Stand up, plead your case before the mountains. Let the hills hear what you have to say. Hear, O mountains, the Lord's accusation. Listen, you everlasting foundations of the earth. For the Lord has a case against his people. He is lodging a charge against Israel. My people, what have I done to you? How have I burdened you? Answer me. I brought you up out of Egypt and redeemed you from the land of slavery. I sent Moses to lead you, also Aaron and Miriam. My people, remember what Balak came. king of Moab counseled, and what Balaam, son of Beor, answered. Remember your journey from Shittim to Gilgal, that you may know the righteous acts of the Lord. With what shall I come before the Lord, and bow down before the exalted God? Shall I come before him with burnt offerings, with calves a year old? Will the Lord be pleased with thousands of rams, with 10,000 rivers of oil? Shall I offer my firstborn for my transgression, the fruit of my body for the sin of my soul? He has shown you, O man, what is good, and what does the Lord require of you? To act justly, and to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. This is the word of the Lord. The lectionary scriptures for this morning really came together very nicely. Many times the lectionary scriptures don't necessarily fit all that well, and so you have one reading at the beginning of the worship service and another reading before the sermon, and they don't necessarily connect. And when the preacher stands up and decides, I'm going to try to connect them, the preacher ends up stretching beyond his or her limits. But this morning they worked well. The Matthew text that tells us, blessed are the poor, blessed are the meek, blessed are those who hunger and thirst, blessed are those who mourn, blessed are those who seek righteousness, blessed are those who are merciful, blessed are those who are persecuted for righteousness' sake. Matches up very well with the instructions of Micah. Say, he has shown you what is good and what the Lord requires of you. Do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. In many ways, the different blessings of people from Jesus' words can go into any of the three categories found in Micah, either acting justly, loving mercy, or walking humbly with God. There's another scripture for this morning, the lectionary from Paul's letter to the Corinthians, that talks about the wisdom of the world versus the wisdom of God. And the call to worship, I will destroy the wisdom of the wise, the intelligence of the intelligent I will frustrate, comes from that scripture. That's a nice reminder for us that Micah 6:8, though we may know it well, and the Beatitudes, though we may know them well, run contrary to the wisdom of the world, run contrary to the way people tend to think and act, and may even run contrary to the way we are, to what we do as people. We hear Micah 6:8 fairly often. It's one of the favorite scriptures. Actually, this week as the email prayers went out, I heard from several people saying, that's one of my favorite scriptures. I love to study it and to learn about it. But one of the possible problems of a favorite scripture like Micah 6:8 or the Beatitudes is we start to think that we really get them. We really understand these scriptures. When Tammy and I were in college, we were involved in InterVarsity Christian Fellowship, and she pointed out that this scripture was printed on a minimum of 4 t-shirts that we got from InterVarsity. The leader of InterVarsity really liked the scripture, and a lot of the college students really got behind it and thought, this is just such a great scripture, and it really is. It's a wonderful scripture on how to live our lives. Do justly, love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. 3 very simple things on the surface. But the question we have to ask ourselves is, if we examine our lives, if we examine our attitudes towards the world, with Micah 6:8, are we really doing that? Are we really doing justly, loving mercy, and walking humbly with our God? To do justly, there are probably 2 main interpretations of what it means to do justly. Either to follow the law, to do justly, to do what has been outlined for us to do, and to follow that to the T, to make sure all the I's are dotted, to make sure that we are doing everything exactly as we have been told. That is one form of doing.
justly, but another form of doing justly is to look after the world's poor, to look after those who have less, those who are sick. To do justly means to make sure justice happens throughout the world. It's not just a simple explanation of what you should do in your day-to-day life, but it is a way of orienting yourself, a way of orienting yourself through God and towards the world, to say, justice matters, and I can do something to bring about justice, not only in my small world, but around the world. I can do something to help with justice. Those are the two kind of typical takes on doing justly, and I think that both have a great deal of accuracy for our lives. To say that we don't really need to have any kind of instructions at all may leave us being a little willy-nilly with justice and only using it when it suits our purposes. But on the other hand, if all we do is live out the letter of the law, then we won't really be doing justice. We won't really be bringing justice into the world. We will only be doing the bare minimum, doing the least amount that's necessary to be able to say, yes, I fulfill the command to do justly. Now, the second thing is to love mercy. To love mercy, and there's kind of a consistent theme of loving mercy where people assume this means be forgiving. When somebody does something wrong to you, forgive them. Be kind to them. Allow them the opportunity to at least make retribution. But loving mercy means more than that. Again, it's more than just allowing those who owe you something to get off, or those who have wronged you forgiveness. Loving mercy means that you look at those who are hurting, those who may have fallen outside the system of justice, those who you can look at and say, I have no doubts that this person didn't deserve what they got. To be merciful means to reach out to those people as well, to help them, to help those who never had a chance in life. Loving mercy is more than just giving a little bit of forgiveness here. And we have a wonderful example of loving mercy from Jesus. Because Jesus' death on the cross was not simply an act to provide us forgiveness for the sins that we have committed. Jesus' death on the cross was in order to reorient the world, was in order to say the way things are done, the way things are happening to people are not right. They're not fair. Some people don't need forgiveness, they just need someone to help them. Some people don't need to be told, well, you've done wrong and now you've got to pay for it. Jesus' death on the cross said, that's not the way it's supposed to be. In the Beatitudes, Jesus says, blessed are those who are merciful. Blessed are the peacemakers. Blessed are those who are persecuted for my sake. Loving mercy moves us beyond just a solitary action, moves us beyond just knowing what to do in certain situations. Loving mercy means that our hearts are constantly open, constantly broken and softened for those who are in need. Loving mercy takes us beyond a single action. And then there is walking humbly with your God. This is probably the most difficult of the three commandments that we have in Micah 6:8. To walk humbly with your God. There are two parts to this. First, I want to tackle the last part of it, with your God. How do you know when you're walking with your God? How do you know that that is what you are doing? That's one of the most difficult questions in a world that feels too little experience of God's presence, in a world that seems to say we can do okay without God, in a world that says, well, maybe God exists, but he's not really here in my day-to-day life. To walk humbly with your God means to live your life as though God is with you at all times, because God is. God is there with you. And then the humbling part means that we recognize our own shortcomings. We recognize that what may seem like wisdom to us, what may seem like wisdom to the world around us, what we may have been taught is wisdom. And what we might be most proud of in our own lives is not really any kind of wisdom at all. It's actually foolishness in the eyes of God. We have to be willing and able to submit ourselves, which is not an easy thing to do in a world that is full of pride, in a world that is all about, look at what I've done, that is all about showing how we have succeeded in the eyes of the world. But we are called to walk humbly with our God, to submit ourselves, to accept that the things that we may think are right maybe aren't, to allow ourselves to learn and grow under a loving Creator. To do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God. Jesus says in the Beatitudes many of the ways we do that, and so we could examine the Beatitudes and say, blessed are those who are poor in spirit. Those are the ones who do justly, the ones who aren't so concerned with worldly wealth, and so they reach out. But that's also part of walking humbly with our God. We could go through each of the Beatitudes and do that. But Jesus taught his followers in another way as well. He didn't just stand up and tell them, okay, do this, 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 and this. Sometimes Jesus told stories, told parables, in order to help his disciples examine their lives more fully. He would say, this is what is right, like Micah 6:8, to do justly, to love mercy, and walk humbly with your God. And then Jesus would tell a story. And he would leave that story without explanation. He would simply say, look at this story. Where do you see yourself in this story? And in what way can you use what I just said to examine both the story and where you find yourself in the story? So this morning I have a parable. And I hope that as I'm reading the parable, as I'm telling the parable, as we go forth into our day-to-day lives, that we'll think about this parable. We'll think about how we fit in, where we might be. And we might find ourselves in multiple places, but we'll allow Micah 6:8 to help us examine ourselves and those around us. There were these two brothers. They grew up without really going to church. As they began to mature and got to be teenagers, a couple of friends invited each of them to two very different churches. The one brother went to a church where they were told that God had explained in the Bible and through correct doctrine exactly how to live and how to think. They were told that they should give 10% of their income, no matter how much or how little they made. They were taught that they should go to worship and Bible study on a weekly basis, no matter what else their plans may have. They were taught to say prayers in the morning, in the evening, and before meals. They were taught to do devotionals each day, and to read the Bible from cover to cover every year. They were taught not to put themselves in situations where they might sin, or to find themselves around those who did sin. They were told exactly what things were sinful, and what things they needed to avoid. Now, the other brother went to a church that taught him the most important thing is having a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. This church taught about the importance of Bible study, worship, and prayer like the other church, but said, that's the time you spend with God, so do it on your time. Make that a part of your life. Didn't say you have to do it on a regular basis. It also taught him that it was important to avoid sin, but it taught him that once he had a personal relationship with God, he wouldn't have to worry about sin anyway because God would constantly be guiding him, would constantly be showing him how to live his life. And so he didn't really have to worry about sin as much, or even having rules and laws to follow in terms of when to read the Bible, when to go to worship, when to pray, when to do devotionals. He didn't really need that. that because he had God. And it also emphasized the importance of feeling and experiencing God. That worshiping God was not so much about doing it exactly the right way, but it was just an experience and a response to that experience. Now, both brothers grew up and were very successful in the business world. They acquired reasonable amounts of wealth and comfort for their lives and for their families. The first brother continued to attend church weekly, to tithe his income, to do his Bible study and devotions, as well as his morning and evening prayers, and to bless each meal. He continued to stay away from temptations that would possibly cause him to sin, and he didn't associate with anyone who was known to commit the sins that he had been told about. He felt he was living a righteous life. The second brother continued to pray whenever he felt led to read the Bible whenever he was in need of guidance, and to go to church whenever he thought he might need to or was hurting and needed a little something extra from God. As the years wore on, he prayed a little less, studied the Bible a little less, and became very irregular in his church attendance. But still, he tried to have a relationship with God and continued to trust that God was guiding every aspect of his life. He did God on his own time and in his own way, but it was a relationship. And to him, that meant he had the most true relationship with God. Which of these two better lived out the instructions? To do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with your God. Let those who have ears hear. Amen. As we think about our lives, as we explore how we can better be in relationship with Jesus Christ, how we can better learn to live by the laws that have been given to us and how to live them out more fully, we invite anyone who has not made a profession of faith in Jesus Christ who would like to say, "I believe and I want to follow," to come forward. We invite anyone who would like to join together with this body of Christ as we learn to do justly, to love mercy, and to walk humbly with our God, to come forward. And if there is anyone here who would like to recommit, rededicate themselves to this endeavor, we invite you to come forward as we sing about walking with God. This morning, when we talk about walking, we're not just talking about something that we do when we're going from one place to another. We're talking about how we live our lives. So for our invitation hymn, we will be singing "Just a Closer Walk with Thee." And then for our processional hymn, we will be singing "I'm Going to Live So God Can Use Me," except instead of "I'm Going to Live," we're going to sing "I'm Going to Walk." Because that says something about how we live our lives, about being in a relationship, about being side by side. So let us stand and sing, and if there is any who would like to say something about their walk with God, we invite you to come forward as we sing our hymn of invitation, number 557, "Just a Closer Walk with Thee."
We will sing two stanzas and their choruses, and then I will play a stanza and a chorus. Then we'll sing the third stanza and the chorus.
Yeah.
tune brought it to mind. I had the good fortune some, not many years ago, to spend a week or so in New Orleans. It was the hotel I was in, the conference I was going to was near the French Quarter. Every spare time I could find, I was there observing and listening and seeing what the French Quarter was all about. Well, one day there was this jazz band. Mixed white and black, probably seven or eight guys and white man leading it. And then one time they started playing this tune. And there was an elderly black gentleman in the crowd, well dressed, he wasn't a better preacher, probably was. About halfway through, he stepped forward, wanting to sing, he stepped forward, began to sing from memory, the whole hymn. And Wayne's probably brought up the story back to mind. To me, it was a very moving experience. The hymn, the spontaneousness of the whole thing, which I think is what worship should be. I don't know who he was, but I'll always remember this event in New Orleans. Thank you, Charles.
Good reminder that God is always present with us. Now please bow for our benediction. Go knowing that indeed, God is always with you, blessing you with his presence. Go, do justly, love mercy, walk humbly with your God. In Jesus' name, amen.